We will begin with the invocation by the Reverend Carlos Rodriguez, pastor of Redeemer Presbyterian Church. If you'd come forward, Carlos, it's good to have you here. If everyone would stand for the invocation, and after the invocation, remain standing for the Pledge of Allegiance. Carlos, we welcome you.
Thank you. Let us pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, your word tells us that you are the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. You do not grow tired or weary, and your understanding no one can fathom. As such, it is fitting at the beginning of the city council meeting that we should call upon you. You say in your word that if anyone lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. Grant to these city council members wisdom and understanding as they deliberate over the affairs of this great city. Give to them, O Lord, a spirit of unity, that they may listen to one another, that they may learn from each other's perspectives, that they may make wise and just decisions that benefit the citizens of Virginia Beach. Bless them with insight, humility, ingenuity, and leadership, that they may govern and serve with diligence and faithfulness. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Carlos, thank you for coming. Appreciate it very much. One thing that the police have asked, if we can make sure we keep the center aisle open, and obviously we got a big crowd tonight, and we just want to make sure that people can get in and out safely. Also, I want to remind everyone that the City Council's speaker policy that allows certain representatives of groups to speak for 10 minutes applies only to planning items and items where a public hearing is required by state law. As to all other items on the agenda, each speaker, whether speaking individually or on behalf of a group, we'll have 3 minutes to speak. At this time, do I have a motion for the certification of the closed session?
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? I'll call for the question, please.
By a vote of 10-0 with Mrs. Kane being absent, you have approved the certification for closed session.
Do I have a motion of approval of the minutes of February 21st, 2017?
So moved.
Second.
Have a motion, a second. Is there any discussion? I'll call for the question, please.
By a vote of 10-0, you have approved the minutes as submitted.
I open a public hearing on excess city property Veterans Care Center near the intersection of West Neck Road and Nemo Parkway.
Your Honor, I have no speaker.
Thank you. Mr. Vice Mayor, if you move forward with the consent agenda, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mayor, I'd like to move for approval of the consent agenda. First, under ordinances and resolutions, item J1, which is an ordinance to amend City Code paragraph 23-59, requirements of off-site parking facilities. Madam Clerk, please note that Mr. Moss is voting no on that item. J2 is an ordinance to readopt the Hampton Roads Hazard Mitigation Plan. Item 5 is the ordinances to declare approximately 26 acres of city property at West Neck Road and Nemo Parkway in excess. B, authorize the transfer of the property to the Commonwealth of Virginia, redevelopment of Veterans Care Center, and C, resolution to designate 2 options for a new school site. J6, ordinance to authorize city manager to execute an agreement between the city and UDT SEAL Museum Association, Inc., Ray, a Navy SEAL monument at 38th Street and the boardwalk, and authorize city manager to accept donation of the monument upon completion. Item 7, ordinance to authorize an independent audit of the city and development authority finances to enter into a contract with Clifton Larson Allen LLP for $178,600 estimated. Item 8, ordinance to modify the Wildlife Response Inc. lease to extend construction milestones. Madam Clerk, please note that the mayor is abstaining on that item.
Yes, Your Honor.
Item nine is ordinances to authorize temporary encroachments. A, Bay Lake Properties LLC, a portion of city property known as Lake Joyce, and the 20-foot strip of city property adjacent to 4444 Shore Drive, Ray Pyle, piers and access walkways. And please note, Madam Clerk, that the mayor is abstaining on that item.
Yes, Your Honor.
And B, Oceana Development LLC, a portion of city property known as Canal 2 at Progress Lane to install a storm drainage pipe. Item 11, which is ordinances to accept and appropriate grant funds from the Virginia Department of Emergency Management. A, $10,000 to the Office of Emergency Management Rate Capabilities and Training for the Citizens Emergency Response Team. And B, $49,151 to the Virginia Task Force 2 Urban Search and Rescue Team Rate Communication Equip.
Public hearing for planning.
Under planning for consent is item K1, which is Elbow Road Investments LLC and Lyman Stewart Clark in the Princess Anne District. And Madam Clerk, please note that Mr. Davenport is abstaining on that item.
Yes, Your Honor.
Item 2 is the application of River City Recovery LLC and MESAG 2 LLC for modification of conditions in the Kempsville District. Item 3, application of Central Drive Mini Storage, Inc. for modification of proffers in the Princess Anne District. Madam Clerk, please note that the mayor is abstaining on that item.
Yes, Your Honor.
Item 4.
Mr. Vice Mayor, I've been just informed there's a speaker on that, so you'll have to pull it, please.
Okay, we'll have to pull that then. Okay. Item 4, the Bunny Hutch, no, Inc.
Item 4 is the one to be pulled.
Item 4 is the one,
yes,
to be pulled.
Yes.
Okay. All right. Item 5. So item 3 is for approval.
Correct.
Item 5 is Smart Mouth Brewing Company, LLC, and Runnymede Corp. for a conditional use permit for Raya Craft Brewery in the Beach District. Madam Clerk, please note that the mayor is abstaining on that item.
Yes, Your Honor.
Item 6, McDonald Garden Market, LLC, and PMIG 1020, LLC, for conditional use permit in the Kempsville District. So moved, Mr. Mayor.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
Any discussion? I'll call for the question, please.
I have voted 10 to 0 with Mrs. Kane being absent. You have approved the consent agenda as read by the Vice Mayor.
Council, as I said earlier today, I will be abstaining everything dealing with the Cavalier. As such, I'll be stepping out and turning the meeting over to the Vice Mayor, and I'll be back when that discussion is over. Thank you.
All right.
And I'll be doing the same too, Mr. Vice Mayor.
Thank you. All right. First thing we'll do is have the public comment on Cavalier Tourism Development Funding Program, Atlantic Avenue Realignment.
Yes, Your Honor. The first speaker is Rona.
I think the city manager would like to present his speaker's staff.
Thank you, Vice Mayor, and it's a request, and for the attending and observing public, we're going to bring forth three leaders. First, Patty Phillips, our Director of Finance, is going to do a summary of the tourism development gap financing. Then she'll be followed by Mr. Brad Van Domelen, who is the Director of the Convention Visitors Bureau Department. He'll talk about the tourism void. And then Mr. Tom Leahy, Deputy City Manager over Public Works, will present the Atlantic Avenue realignment and then also talk about the TPOF grant. These will be very short. They'll be summaries of what the council was briefed on last Tuesday. So, Ms. Patty, please.
Welcome, Patty.
As Mr. Hansen said, this is really a very short version of things you've seen before. Is this how I?
It's on.
Okay.
I got it.
Just as a recap of what the request is the, thank you, Cavalier Associates has requested to be paid an incentive payment each year based on the 1% local sales tax that is generated by the project only. It is not an upfront payment. I know some of the articles that I've read are a little bit confusing, but there is not a $6.5 million upfront payment to the Cavalier for the Embassy Suites. The 1% local sales tax would be rebated back as an incentive to the developer to support the developer's loan. Some of the criteria that we use in evaluating these projects is, does it fill a tourism void? This is an upper upscale hotel. For those you all know, there's Smith Travel Research, also referred to as the Star Report, that evaluates hotels based on various classifications. They have evaluated this Embassy Suites as an upper upscale hotel. In addition, there is significant executive meeting space in the Embassy. There'll be 8,000 square feet. That coupled with what's in the Marriott, that'd be over 30,000 square feet of executive meeting space. New taxable sales will be added of $17 million a year. The private investment in the hotel is $56 million. Parking will be increased from what was previously planned at 300 spaces to now 521 spaces. And the fiscal impacts to the city, in other words, the fiscal impacts to the city over a 20-year period net present value after payment of incentives is $65 million to the taxpayers, after incentives, after displacements, and so forth. And again, the developer is taking out the loan. It is not an obligation of the city. This chart is a picture of, just to kind of give you an orientation. On the left side, you'll see the TDFP in 2014, the historic Cavalier was approved, and also the Marriott. And in the red is the application for 2017 to add the Embassy Suites. Again, what is the program? It is where the developer would have received project-generated 1% local sales tax that would help support private sector debt service that would basically close the project's financial gap. In other words, after they've approached banks for a regular loan, this is the amount that could not be supported otherwise without this additional incentive. It fills the tourism void, as we said, and it also creates a three-way partnership. That'd be the 1% local sales tax rebate, a 1% state sales tax rebate. In addition, the developer would have to charge a 1% access fee that would also be rebated back. And again, the city's contribution is from the 1% on-premises generated revenues only. As a refresher, back in 2013, council appropriated $18 million for the project. You'll see the $8.2 million from our EDIP program. There was also $2.3 million for historic space, historic preservation easement, and also $2.4 million for the Cavalier Drive, one-time cost of $13. And they would also receive annual grants based on the increased value of real estate taxes up to $5 million for that $18 million. In addition, they were approved for a tourism development financing grant for the historic Cavalier and the Oceanfront Hotel. Again, 1% of the sales tax generated by those two pieces until a total of $6 million plus interest is supported. That was estimated to be less than 14 years. Again, not an upfront payment.
Can you speak up for a chance?
Excuse me?
Can't hear. You're not here.
Can't hear me?
No. Louder.
No. Okay, how about now?
Yes.
Okay, put my mouth right in this thing. This is a summary of where the project stands today. About $74 million is the cost of the historic Cavalier, $105 million for the Oceanfront Marriott and Embassy Suites, estimated $56 million for $235 million. Equity Historic Cavalier, 56.5, Oceanfront Marriott, 24.9, and the Embassy Suites, 11.2, for a total of $92.6 million in equity and credits. They anticipate bank debt, a total of $117.9 million. The gap that was approved in 2014 for the Cavalier and the Oceanfront Marriott was $4 million and $14 million, respectively. That piece has not changed. While the overall cost of the projects have increased, the gap has not. The gap of the Embassy Suites is projected at $6.5 million, bringing that to $24.5 million. I also want to reiterate again that the city portion of this is the 1% sales tax generated by these three pieces of the project until the developer loan has been satisfied, estimated between 14 and 15 years. The city's portion is $8.17 million plus interest until that portion is satisfied. Sort of a recap here. The criteria the city has used at the investment to qualify for this program must be over $30 million. This is $56 million. The total project, all components, have increased over $87 million since first contemplated in 2013. We also put our own threshold of its sales must be over $1 million. Of course, the Embassy Suites is over $17 million. Annual sales for the whole project, the three hotels, the Cavalier, the Marriott, and the Embassy Suites, is projected at $63.2 million a year, which will generate $632,000 of the 1% local sales tax and a like amount for the state and a like amount for the developer access fee for a total of $1.9 million that would be used towards gap financing. Again, as we said, upper upscale hotel, conference space, it's a redevelopment project, and meeting space between the Marriott and the Embassy is over 30,000 square feet. Where are we going from here? There was a Virginia Beach Development Authority open session brief and decision on February 21st. We had a public briefing by City Council, for City Council, on February 21st, and today is a public hearing in the City Council ordinance. If Council approves this, we'll enter into a performance agreement as required by the state and forward to the Virginia Tourism Corporation, which is preliminarily given approval and reviewed by the state controller by this week. And I also want to point that the performance agreement will include a requirement if the project should come in under budget, then the amount of the gap would be decreased. I'm going to turn this now over to Brad, who will talk a little bit about the gap and the void.
Thank you, Patty, Mr. Hansen, members of council. As was mentioned, my name is Brad Van Domlin. I'm the director of the Virginia Beach Convention and Visitors Bureau, and I'll be brief. I'd like to just kind of highlight a few elements to demonstrate why the Cavalier Resort, as proposed, fills a tourism void in Virginia Beach. First off, many of our hotels, the hotel product, is really focused on leisure transient business with many fewer hotels that are focused in the business meetings industry. With the Cavalier's plans, with their amenities, the number of guest rooms that they'll have, and the meeting space, it will truly provide a new convention hotel product to a scale that we don't currently offer in Virginia Beach, and will definitely help our destination be more competitive in the group market. Also, from a standpoint of the number of guest rooms that they'll be providing, the amount of square footage, over 30,000 square feet, managed by one company, and given the ability for meeting planners to book the entire campus concept under one single group contract, it offers what we call a under one roof type of concept that we just don't have available at that scale in Virginia Beach. When the old Cavalier was raised, we displaced a number of meetings that have traditionally met in Virginia Beach that have not returned because we lost that under one roof type of capability with the amount of guest rooms and meeting space that the old Cavalier had. With this new product, we'll be able to invite many of those groups back to Virginia Beach, and we also have a long list of groups that we've identified that have a profile that would also be likely candidates for considering a project like this that would give us an opportunity to market Virginia Beach to a new set of customers that we don't currently have in Virginia Beach. In addition, in trying to expand Virginia Beach's business volume to more of a year-round destination, over 75% of our group business comes to Virginia Beach in the non-peak season. So by growing our meeting assets in Virginia Beach, we have the ability to attract more year-round business, which of course is very good for jobs and is also good for growing our tax base. And lastly, data that we received from Smith's Travel Industry regarding the upper upscale chain scale category, when you look at that and evaluate the year-over-year growth of all the different categories in the chain scale, the upper upscale category is nearly double the amount of growth in volume than all the other chain scale categories, which really demonstrates that there is a demand and an interest for upscale product in Virginia Beach. So in summary, as the official destination marketing organization for Virginia Beach, it is our opinion that the Cavalier Resort's plans as proposed will provide new product that will enhance our ability to improve our competitive position in the marketplace as a destination, and certainly will help us attract more group business to Virginia Beach. Thank you.
Good evening, Vice Mayor Jones and members of council. I'll try to be very brief. I know these presentations were made a number of times before. So the realignment of Atlantic Avenue, which is being requested by Cavalier Associates, would involve terminating Atlantic Avenue about 500 feet north of 40th Street in a cul-de-sac.
We're not making that decision today.
The changes would involve cul-de-sacking Atlantic Avenue about 500 feet north of 40th Street. The current traffic between Atlantic and Pacific would be redirected over 40th Street. Turn lanes would be added on 40th and Pacific to facilitate this transition. It would sacrifice about 12 parking spaces on 40th Street and 4 on Pacific. About up to 10 of those parking spaces could be recovered on the cul-de-sac section of Atlantic Avenue north of 40th Street. Sidewalks and landscaping would be added. Utilities would be relocated and undergrounded as appropriate. The existing light at Pacific and Atlantic would be removed because that intersection would no longer exist. New traffic light would be installed at 40th and Pacific, and two blocks to the north, a new traffic light at 42nd and Atlantic. So there's a this slide shows the existing alignment with the changes superimposed. I would like you to note the two slivers of property to the east and the west of the cul-de-sac. On the east is a 2,200 square foot piece of property that is owned by Cavalier Associates. They would have to dedicate that property to the city. To the west of the cul-de-sac is a pie-shaped parcel owned by VDOT that includes a 1,600 square foot parcel or piece of property that would also be part of the cul-de-sac. And I'll explain later, we would need VDOT to dedicate that property to us as well. And that's pretty much the same slide showing the realignment with the proposed Marriott Hotel, the Embassy Suites, the garage, and the Grand Lawn entrance simulated with the tree canopies coming down from the historic Cavalier. So the objectives and goals and benefits that are hoped to be achieved through the realignment, well, one would be to mitigate the traffic congestion and the safety issues that are anticipated due to the large influx during a conference type meeting in and out that would, under the current alignment, would stack traffic right out into Atlantic Avenue and create what's believed to be pretty intolerable conditions. It would allow the developer, Cavalier Associates, to create an off-street vehicular stacking corridor that he could stack up to approximately 80 or 80 plus. It would create a grand or regal entrance that would be befitting of what is going to be a grand and regal facility with the and match the upscale nature of the facility, which is a pretty big deal, I think, in marketing the facility. It would simulate the historic Grand Lawn view shed between the historic Cavalier and the new hotels by using tree canopies so that you would see this green lawn or green tree canopy from the historic Cavalier all the way down to the oceanfront. It would allow us to accommodate a new trolley stop, and it would allow trolleys and other vehicles to make a turnaround in the cul-de-sac and safely without having to go around the block on Atlantic and Pacific. So how much does it cost, and how much and how would we pay for it? The total cost is $2.5 million, and everyone understands that City Council is does not intend to pay for it. That brings up the issue of the Transportation Partnership Opportunity Fund, or what we call the TPOF grant. It's grants or loans or other financing tools that are authorized by the governor to address transportation aspects associated with economic development projects. Funds can be used for virtually any transportation project. The one limitation is that they're available only to agencies and subdivisions of the Commonwealth of Virginia. So the city would have to be the owner of the property and the owner of the grant, the applicant for the grant, and the owner of the construction project. And that gets back to that property that I indicated, VDOT, and the developer would have to dedicate to the city for this to go forward. So I think there's been a lot of discussion about the traffic impacts from this. The Cavalier Associates did commission a traffic study. Was prepared by McPherson Consulting back in August of 2016. It used as a baseline baseline of the existing condition that included an estimate for the historic Cavalier being renovated and the new properties surrounding the historic Cavalier on the west side. It looked at the existing condition and then assumed the dual hotel and conference center facility. At that time, they estimated 453 rooms. That number might be a little bit larger now. 28 condominiums and apartments, and at that time, a 500 space parking garage. I think that's up to about 521. So compared to the existing base condition, this project, with or without the realignment, is estimated to increase traffic in the area by about 14%. Now, again, that's compared to the existing condition with a vacant lot at the on the east end of the project. So if you included the former Cavalier or even what the developer proposes to build right today, the increase in traffic is less than that. But the one of the number that one of the most important numbers in the study is that during the summertime evening hours, peak hours, this project facility would add 284 additional trips on and off the roads, split halfway roughly between coming into the facility and leaving the facility. You need to compare this to the existing traffic conditions in Atlantic Avenue north of 42nd Street, which is about 20,000 vehicles per day. That's what we call level of service B. Level of service B is stable traffic, slight delays. And then the level, the traffic that's on Pacific Avenue south of 40th Street, and that's about 22,400 vehicles per day. That's also level of service B. I'd point out that the Atlantic Avenue right there at the oceanfront south of 40th Street has what we call level of service C, which is stable traffic with acceptable or reasonable delays, and that's about 5,100 vehicles per day. All right, so looking at the reconfiguration assessment, what all this would cause to happen, the new traffic signal at 42nd and Pacific would operate at level service B, which is still, again, stable traffic, slight delays. The new traffic signal at 40th and Pacific would operate at level of service C, stable traffic, acceptable or reasonable delays. Anything that, reasonable if, for what anybody would expect at a traffic intersection with a lot of vehicles there. The Obviously, the Atlantic and Pacific Avenue going north and south are expected to increase by about 14%, but they would still remain under their current status, which is level of service B. Big number that I think everybody would want to know is how much traffic is coming off of Atlantic Avenue on the ocean side, transitioning across 40th Street to the Atlantic Avenue headed north. That's about 320 vehicles per hour, summertime PM peak hours. And again, the final impact, 16 spaces are given up by the traffic realignment, and up to 10 can be recovered on the cul-de-sac to Atlantic Avenue. At that point, I'd take any questions if you have any.
Anybody have any questions for Mr. Leahy?
Great.
No.
I do have just one point, not a question, but just since these are two separate items, I just want to make sure the public knows they can speak both on gap financing and they can then speak on the closure. There are two separate votes. They have two opportunities to speak.
Thank you, Mr. Leahy. Do you have any other presenters? Mr. Hanson?
No, sir. Thanks for the opportunity to update everyone.
Thank you. All right, we'll proceed with the speakers on the public comment. Madam Clerk?
Your Honor, the speakers signed in such a way as they will speak one time on all of these items, so I don't know how to divide that out because they didn't divide it themselves.
Well, they
the public comment and the agenda items, they've registered to speak on.
Mr. Moss is correct, and that is that there are two separate items, actually three separate items here.
I just don't know how to divide
and,
it. I
think what we will do is, if there's any further speakers who want to speak on the public comment, we'll hear them now, and then we will combine items two or items three and four when we get to the ordinances.
Would you like me to call the names and let them come forward if they're going to speak on the comment?
Vice Mayor, not to be argumentative, but since those require separate votes and are divisionable questions, they are separate items, and people are entitled to speak on every item on the agenda.
Well, you're correct, and if you, that's what the way you want it done,
I think
that's
what
we'll do.
So.
Your Honor, should I just call the names and let them come forward if they're speaking on the comment?
Yes, just the ones speaking on the comment.
I have to call all the names because they didn't tell me what they want.
All right, that's fine.
R.J. Nutter. And these are all 3 minutes.
Yes, ma'am. Since we're dividing these, I did not realize that, Mr. Moss. I'll try my best to speak up. Since we're dividing these, I did not realize that. I'll be very brief on the public comment and reserve my presentation on each of the other remaining issues. But I did want to say thank you on behalf of Cavalier Associates at this juncture to our liaisons on City Council. As you know, the Council appoints liaisons for projects of this nature. And we appreciate the hard work those gentlemen paid to this project over a considerable period of time. In addition, I'd like to thank the staff. Mr. Hanson and his staff have been wonderful. They have asked more
questions. Can't hear you.
I wonder if the media people can turn up the.
I'm working on it. You got to talk loud, RJ.
All right, I'll
Come
do my
on.
Best. I can't get into this, but so much. But anyway, I'll lean forward as much as I can. I'll keep very brief to thank staff for all the hard work they put into this project, and I want to thank the council liaisons who worked with us over several months on this project. I'll reserve the rest of my speaking presentation for the other items as they come up on the agenda, Mr. Moss, and turn it over to the other speakers on the public comment period.
Thank you.
Bruce Chisholm.
Words matter. Words have meaning. Words are omitted that change meaning. Resolution, line 15, I quote, the road project would end in cul-de-sac Atlantic Avenue, end quote. Cul-de-sac means dead end. This road project is not a dead end, but will, quote, line 17, allow the developer to access the oceanfront elements of the redevelopment, end quote. It's an entrance to access the to-be-built Embassy Suites at the expense of our residents and visitors to our great city. Quote, line 46, the road project would allow the simulation of the historic Grand Lawn, end quote. The words that are missing here are the developer will use the simulated grand lawn for 5 traffic lanes and 80 parking spaces, according to the developer at the January information session. The city manager's presentation to you in December and his presentation with the developer at the convention center in January differ from the words in the resolution. The proposed cul-de-sac was to have only a gated service entrance for a few delivery trucks each day to the Cavaliers 150-unit hotel and timeshare. The agenda item, but not the resolution, clearly states that this, quote, is necessary to resolve on-site parking alignments, end quote. The resolution calls for the Commonwealth to transfer, line 28, quote, the Atlantic Avenue right-of-way and remnant pieces from previous realignments of Atlantic Avenue, end quote, not counting the roadway and the residual parcels, which are VDOT's terms. Words matter. The city is gifting, by my estimate, around an acre of property. If you want the residual property, let it remain green space. I don't have time to address the traffic issues. The resolution is not a solution, it creates problems. 40th Street is 300 feet long, with proposed 150-foot turn lanes. A tour coach is 50 feet long. A delivery tractor trailer can be longer. Do not tamper with Atlantic Avenue. Allow the developer who already has a by-right entrance to use it. I oppose the Atlantic Avenue realignment and the agenda item funding it and transferring of property. 1,208 residents signed an online petition opposing this realignment. Madam Clerk, I ask you to accept the petition. City Council, do the right thing. Do not approve this agenda item. Thank you.
You have the petition. Reed Grenham, are you speaking on the comment?
Yes, I am. Good evening, not here, Mr. Mayor, rest of City Council. I signed up to speak on all of the agenda items, each individual agenda item. So I'm very happy that the mayor is not here, Mr. Earn is not here. I think that there are a lot of issues involved in this. And overall, I don't think we should have been involved in this project in the first place. I don't think it's the responsibility of City Council to subsidize one particular developer over another. I think ethically, this is not what we should be doing. So my general comment is we talk a lot about gap financing and avoid. What I find is there's a gap in City Council understanding what the taxpayers and the citizens of our city want us to do. And this is not what we want you to do. And there's a void in the integrity and priorities of this organization. You've spent an inordinate amount of time working on this project when there are far greater needs in our city than this particular project. I disagree with all of this. And if we've learned anything over the years, every one of you, it's when the deal first comes to us, it's only this, and we vote on it. And then we're sucked into the void, and then it's going to be, well, we just need to add this. And then we just need to do that. That's been demonstrated here over and over since we did the 31st Street Hotel project, which coincidentally involved Mr. Thompson. So what I want to say in my general comment is, and I'm sorry I have to do this, but I think when it comes to voting on this, I think, Rosemary, you should recuse yourself or remove yourself from voting on these issues. Your husband had an interest in Town Bank in providing that information, and
no,
that creates
no
a conflict of interest.
We had no interest in Town Bank.
I have a letter here from Town Bank dated April 18th, 2014. And it talks about the appointment of Dixon Hughes Goodman LLP as Town Bank's independent auditors. And did you not have an interest in that business?
That was my husband's, and he's passed
right.
away.
And you still no longer have an interest in that business? You're not a beneficiary of anything to do with that business? Okay. So you may want to consider, and I don't want to do this, I'm just saying.
I have a letter from the attorney that says that.
So we need to look at these conflicts of interest. I'm glad the mayor recused himself and Mr. Earn. There's a lot of tie-ins with Town Bank and this project. And as city council, you guys need to be careful of the appearance of impropriety. So my general comment, since I'm running out of time, and we'll get to the particulars of this, is we shouldn't have done this in the first place. I asked you not to do it. And more, it's just more and more tax money, and the deal gets worse and worse. So please, in the future, consider that before you commit yourself to being a business partner with someone when your interest is to represent our interests. Thank you.
Mr. Stiles, did you have a comment?
Mr. Vice Mayor, for the record, Ms. Wilson has been advised my office over a period of several years that the interest in Dixon
Goodman
is an interest that needs to be disclosed, and she has disclosed that by a written letter, and that is all the Conflict of Interest Act requires her to do under these circumstances.
Thank you, Mr. Stowe. Next speaker.
Good evening, Council.
Good evening.
Once again, I have to follow Reed. Reed stole my thunder again. He should have just dropped the mic. I really wrestled. I wanted to come and talk to you guys tonight, and I wrestled with what I was going to talk to you guys about. Then I looked around the room, and I saw that there were just many, many people that could talk more eloquently to the details of this whole thing than I ever could dream to do. But I'll echo what Reed had to say. You guys have missed a few opportunities along the way. This is an opportunity for you to show the taxpayers of Virginia Beach that you have integrity, that you're not going to be pushed around or you're not going to be led around in these projects like has happened time and time and time again. We just had a project finish up a few years ago on Laskin Road. Same thing happened. What a coincidence. At the end, it was, we need to fix the road here. We need to do improvements. We need more money. More money, more money. And that money is going to come from us, the taxpayer. You can talk about your gap financing. Where does that come from? The taxpayer. You can talk about incentives and all this kind of stuff. And where does it ultimately come from? The taxpayer. Yes, it comes from the tourists, okay? But I'd like to be able to go to some of these amenities too, and you know what? The average taxpayer can't afford to, okay? But you've missed an opportunity, a few opportunities along the way. Most recently, I spoke at the light rail, you know, repealing the tax. You missed an opportunity, a very, very good opportunity, I might add, to bond yourselves back with taxpayers. There are many, many, many tens of thousands of people out there that are angry with you. I don't know if you understand that. I don't know if you really understand that. Get out and talk to people other than what's in your district. Go out and talk to people, and I'm sure you do. I'm not saying that you guys sit in your living rooms and make decisions based on, you know, nothing. I'm sure you talk to people. But get down and talk to the guys that are digging the ditches, that are in the trenches every day, that are making $30,000, $40,000 a year, trying to figure out how they're raising two kids and a family and a mortgage and all that other stuff on $40,000 a year, and then you're asking, oh, well, you know what, it's only $2.5 million for this cul-de-sac or whatever. So I want to just be on the record that I'm against any more money being thrown at the Cavalier project. And that's really all I have to say at this point. Thank you.
Danny Furman.
Good evening, City Council members. My name is Stanley Furman. I live at the Oceans Condominium on 40th and Atlantic. I represent the Owners Council. I'm the president. We are 224 units. with approximately $84 million worth of assessed value. Our community sits in the corner or the section of 40th and the Cavalier development. We border Pacific Avenue on west of the property line and the ocean itself on the east. Arguably, our residents are the most directly affected by the proposed realignment of Atlantic Avenue. The extension discussion among the owners and the board has been heated. It's not unanimous, but the board has gratefully, or they have approved unanimously to the alignment. And the reason we did is because Mr. Hansen has told us that we would have input. So far, we have had input. His office has been gracious in allowing us to have input, and we have changed some things along the way. And I believe that if he continues on this path, we will back the proposal of the realignment. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Next speaker.
Ken Chord. Ken Chord.
I'm going to kill two birds. Everybody would be happy with that. Maybe. I'm going to start off by predicting that Mr. Moss and Ms. Abbott will most likely be the only ones who will vote no regarding the Cavalier and the realignment agenda. As to whether or not the city should increase the funding from $18 million to $24.5 million for the Cavalier, the answer should be an obvious no. The developer had already made it known that he would feel uncomfortable about asking for more money, and yet here he is again asking for more money. What he needs to do is invest the profits from the hotel that he's currently building and reinvest that into the third hotel that he wants to develop on his property. I can't promise the people this won't be the last time the city will come to the taxpayers to foot the bill for a project at the oceanfront. However, how many do-overs must take place before the city council says, you've had your chance? When it comes to the Atlantic Avenue realignment, it is really our money the city is going to use. The citizens are paying the taxes to the state, and in return, being used on projects which are being used against the people, which is called Agenda 21. And most people know it as Virginia Beach 2040. This is also going on like nobody's business over in California, Monterey, whatever their year is. It is well documented by mayors and other high political figures, and I do have that to back it up, that the goal is for everyone to live in high density areas, AKA villages. These villages are where bicycle, walking, and mass transit will be the only transportation options. The whole goal is to force people out of their cars. And if you don't believe me, all the red and pink in this, that is what's going to be developed. You think this is going to be the only one that's left? Your tax dollars are going to be sucked out of this. This is not the only SGA, which is a strategic growth area. There's about seven others. So I don't understand what is going on, but y'all need to stop it. Because I'm sure a lot of these other people, these common people, not the people that are making close to six figures, but the people that are really working to be the backbone of the city, are here to say no. Enough's enough. And I have more documents, but I can't go into that. You know, enough's enough. That's what I have to say.
Jack Drescher.
Perhaps I should direct my comments toward you.
Maybe.
Vice Mayor, thank you, members of council. I'm Jack Drescher. I represent the North Virginia Beach Civic League. I'm president of that organization, and I'm here in support of the realignment. We, the Civic League board, spent a lot of time dealing with this issue. This all started back in 2013 when the Buckingham County Circuit Court judge decided they were going to split up the Cavalier properties and put them up for public auction. That happened, and we wanted, and we endorsed a letter to you to support the maintaining of the Cavalier on the Hill. That's what we wanted to keep. And that happened with one bidder. It turned out to be Bruce Thompson. Now, Cavalier Associates, which evolved from Mr. Thompson's organization, came to us and discussed everything from the residential neighborhood that surrounds the hotel to the realignment. And we have spent countless hours dealing not only with him, but with city employees, traffic engineers in particular, and financiers, to discuss how this would best occur to protect the North End. And that's what I'm here to discuss with you very briefly. We are interested in one thing, and that is the preservation of our neighborhood. And we were very, very concerned at the outset of this endeavor that perhaps some 3,200 units were going to be built on our southern border, which would have wreaked havoc on our quality of life. And so Cavalier Associates came forward and put the project before you. It's been approved. The funding has gone through. And of late, actually starting in 2015, Cavalier Associates approached us with the realignment of Atlantic Avenue and 40th Street. And at first, we were against it. We felt like, why would we want to get involved with a street closure and then reroute traffic? But it became readily apparent to us that the fundamental issue with which we had to deal was one of safety and traffic management. We have only two means of ingress and egress in reality to the North End, Shore Drive and Atlantic Avenue at 42nd Street. And so it was imperative from our perspective to make sure that public safety and proper traffic management occurred in that area. And so the city came up with a plan, the traffic engineering department. We met with the traffic engineer, we met with the deputy city manager, and discussed with them what was the very best option available to us. And we were open-minded about it. We wanted to know which would best protect the safety of traffic, vehicular, pedestrian, and bicycle in that area. And the 40th Street realignment was the reason. We endorse that project. We think it's in the best interest of our neighborhood, and frankly, we think it's in the best interest of the city, and we encourage you to approve that plan.
Thank you, Mr. Director.
Diana Howard.
Good evening, everyone. I don't know what to say. Everybody else has said most everything I was going to say, but this developer, for some reason, cannot do a project in Virginia Beach without coming to the taxpayers for help. If you wonder why people are asking for a disparity study, this is it, you know? Because it's not really a black or white issue. It's a crony capitalism issue.
Yes.
You know? A vote for increasing gap financing for the Cavalier Restoration Project is proof that crony capitalism is alive and well in Virginia Beach. So please do not vote for it. We've already gone down this route. We've given them gap financing of $18 million for the Cavalier. We also spent $18 million for the preserve that beautiful, iconic lawn that he has now ruined with all those houses all the way down it. And now he wants to redirect the traffic so that he can have a nice little stop at his place there so he can do valet parking and everything. Is every other business around here allowed to keep a 1% of their sales tax to pay off their bills, their loans? I don't think any other business gets that kind of treatment. So I don't understand why we're doing this. It's not fair to the other businesses that were losing parking so that, you know, they don't have people be able to park freely to go to their businesses, and they have to be rerouted around to get to them. There's no free traffic to get people to go where they want to go. But if you want to go to Fort Story or go down to Shore Drive to one of those restaurants or anything, and you live on this side, so you have to go around, you have to be stopped several times. I mean, I just don't understand what you all are thinking about this. We are not Bruce Thompson's ATM.
Mr. Vice Mayor, members of council, I will be brief, and I'm going to double click on a couple of the points that have already been made. $18 million already.
Now we're talking about another 6.5. The issue is, someone asked, why are we doing this? Well, the only thing I've heard, Patty, you did a great job of giving us the financial reason why this makes sense. My question is, compared to what? Compared to what? What are the opportunity costs? Some of you, I got an MBA, some of you know exactly what I'm talking about. That $18 million that you already gave away, the $6.5 million you're thinking about giving away, the $2.5 million, which also belongs to us. It's coming from the state, but I think everybody in here pays state taxes as well. So why are we giving this money to Bruce Thompson? Bruce Thompson is a friend of mine. But the point is, what else could you be doing with that money? So when Patty says this is a great deal financially, compared to what? Why couldn't we take that same money and create great paying jobs? Cyber, medical encoding. There are a whole host of things you could be doing to this. And we are the largest city in Virginia, but we have a small town mentality because we have small town leadership. That's what's going on. And that's exactly why you see all these people here tonight. They are sick and tired of this. They want you to do the right thing. Again, we have nothing against Bruce Thompson. But what we do have a problem with is taking taxpayer dollars and wasting it on something like this when you could be using those tax dollars to actually move our economy forward. The last thing I'll say is this. This is not the city's money. These are taxpayer dollars. These are our dollars. And so for you to go ahead and again, treat Bruce separately, it creates this perception. Why do you think you have people marching for a disparity study? This is not about black and white. It's about right and wrong. We have people in this country who look at Virginia Beach and say, this is not a place that's open for everybody. And that's not the message we want to send around the state. It's not the message we want to send around the country. You need to vote no on this. This is not a good deal. Thank you and God bless you.
Bernice Pope.
Call it again.
She's coming.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Bernice Pope, and I'm president of the Cavalier Historic, Cavalier Shores Historic Civic League. And I just wanted to come tonight and mention that the Historic Cavalier Shores Civic League has had many concerns about the impact of the Cavalier Complex development on our neighborhood. Our concerns revolve around parking, traffic through our neighborhood, and pedestrian safety, especially among our children. We have met with several council members of the council, along with representatives from the city and manager's office and traffic engineering. These city representatives have been responsive to our concerns, and it appears that the city is willing to make improvements to our neighborhood to reduce traffic and increase safety. The city is also willing to support a revised RPP program for our neighborhood. We wish to thank the city for stepping up and understanding the potential negative impact the increased density and change in traffic pattern will have on our neighborhood. The city has committed to continue to work with the Civic League to minimize any negative effects of the Cavalier Complex to our community and surrounding commercial establishments around our neighborhood. I just want to make one other comment that was brought up tonight about the light on 42nd Street, that our Civic League was opposed to that traffic light. The McPherson traffic study did not warrant a light being there, and we don't support it either. All right, thank you so much.
Thank you.
George Mims.
Good evening, Vice Mayor Jones. For the record, I'm E. George Mims, president of SeaTac Community Civic League. Number one, I rise in opposition to this because of the terrible imbalance citywide. For all the reasons persons have already said, one individual enjoys endless business opportunities while other small women, minority businesses, the city is not lifting that great of a finger, let alone a hand, to help small business. I truly believe that we have more small businesses in this city than we have Cavaliers. And I believe if this city today would raise the same kind of financial opportunities for small women and minority businesses in this city as requested for the disparity study, I think in the future you will have a greater city. It's not the greatest city in the world, obviously, with this somewhat questionable imbalance in opportunities. And if we are going to be a world city, then we must treat all of the people of the world who desire to do business with the city, do business in the city, somewhat the same. Secondly, I did not want to disrupt the proceedings, so I refrained from approaching with regards to the issue of the 10 minute versus 3 minutes. Honorable Chair, if you would allow, I would like to enter 15 copies of my objections to that issue for the record.
Just give it to the clerk and she'll do it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Rona Marsh.
Good evening, City Council. I am just a frustrated taxpayer. That's all I am. I don't represent anyone except myself. And a few of you on council may have seen me at various civic meetings and what have you. But I want to make sure that everybody understands that banks finance developers. This is a common thing. People who want money, who are developers, they go to banks. As I look around here, I do not see a bank. Okay? And so if somebody wants to borrow money, they should go to a bank. Now, obviously, the Cavalier Project has already gone to a bank. The banks to be willing to lend the money to the Cavalier development. And I'm saying if the risk is too great for the banks to lend more money on this development, why in the world is City Council looking at getting involved by lending more money again? Okay?
Yes.
Now, we deal with a lot of banks here. I've read some of our recent reports, and I read our 2017 interim financial cash report. And we deal with Bank of America, BB&T, Morgan Keegan, SunTrust Bank, Town Bank Investments. We have millions of dollars with these banks. So someone could say to this developer, these are good banks, go talk to them, okay? It's really a basic concept. If I want to borrow money, I have to go to a bank. I don't get to come to you here at City Hall and say, lend me money. And what frustrates me even more is the 800-pound gorilla in the room. I have passed out 15 copies to you all of the CAFR, the 2016 CAFR, and on it is actually only the 2015 page about the total pension liability. So we're a year behind in this, but there's a $130 million drop. Let me say that again. $130 million drop in the net investment income that our pension fund earned for the city, okay? In the year before, they earned $194 million, but last year, because things weren't as rosy with the markets, it only earned $64 million, but it paid out $82 million. So while we're over here trying to give money to a developer, we are not really aware of what's happening with our pension fund. At least you're not telling me as a citizen where it is right now. And I'm concerned that that's the 800-pound gorilla in the room, because there are cities all across the country that are going into bankruptcy. And the reason that they're going into bankruptcy is because of their retirement legacy costs. Now, we're not there yet.
Ma'am, your time's up.
Okay. I'll come back. Yeah. I will come back.
Howdy, folks. You know,
I got to tell you, I got in a quarrel with Bruce Thompson. He's always been nice to me, and indeed, he's brought many fine projects to our city. He is availing himself to funding and programs that are made available by the city and state government. And I'm not ashamed to admit that I was wrong about not supporting 31st Street project. That turned out pretty well. But I do wonder if the reason why King Neptune doesn't have a shirt on is because somebody done gave it to Bruce Thompson. Although I wonder if we're finding ourselves in a situation where too far east might be west, and I'm wondering what will happen if one day it all goes south. I wonder if we're putting too many of our economic eggs, if you will, in the same basket. Now, Mr. Thompson, by all accounts, is a savvy businessman and a first-class real estate developer, but what happens if he's not there one day? What if something happens wherein he's no longer running the show and the person who takes his place might not be as confident or diligent? What if the market goes sideways or worse? What could our future hold if we suffer a natural disaster or civil order problems like we did back in the 1980s that damages Virginia Beach's marketability? Wouldn't we be wiser to spread out that risk rather than allowing one company to shoulder it all? Remember, Gold Key PHR is responsible to protect the taxpayers' investments in their project, but we can't vote them out of office if something untoward happens. So this is, at best, a shotgun wedding. Now, when the mayor was a banker, if he saw an application come across his desk for a $276,000 car loan from me because I wanted to buy a new Ferrari Spider, once he was able to stop laughing at the thought of my big butt trying to crawl in and out of that car, and he was able to compose himself, I'm sure he'd have me in for a conversation and explain to me in the nicest terms possible why I couldn't afford this car, and it just wouldn't make me any more attractive to the opposite sex. While I might not like the first half of his answer, because we both know the second part really speaks to the heart of the matter, if the car didn't kill me, my wife surely would. But we both understand that the responsible answer would be no. I kind of feel the same way here. I haven't seen anything to convince me this is a necessity to finish it in this project, and I'm beginning to worry that we're getting too steeply involved in something that is literally at the mercy of market forces, which can be upended by nearly anything, even a rumor, at the drop of a hat. But speaking to the true heart of this matter, I've never really been comfortable with how the Economic Development Authority or other agencies of the city, who are appointed by the council and not elected by the people, decide to approve these projects on one hand and then hands the bill over to the taxpayers for another pro forma approval that you take in the form of a vote. That's all I have to say. Y'all can judge yourselves accordingly, and I'm sure you're going to pass it anyway regardless of what we say, and that's really the heartbreaking part of this matter. Thank you.
Madam Clerk, is that all the speakers on? Thank you. All right. We will now go to ordinances and resolutions, and the first ordinance that we will go to is the ordinance to amend ordinance 3326E to increase the gap financing authorization Ray the Cavalier restoration and to authorize other actions consistent with the state tourism development financing program. Speakers, Madam Clerk.
R.J. Nutter.
First, let me assure you I'll do everything I can to speak as loud as I can, as long as my voice holds out, so forgive me. For the record, my name is R.J. Nutter. I represent Cavalier Associates, and I'd like to begin by addressing a couple of the comments made by those who spoke earlier and let you know that a couple of things that are grossly out of order. In fact, if I had to say there's a gap here today, it's a gap between the understanding of these programs, what they're intending to achieve, what they have achieved, and the citizens' understanding of that program. As the speakers have said, these are state programs designed to encourage and enhance the tourism industry. They were adopted by the General Assembly. They've been adopted by this council. And you have strict standards as to when to apply them. Now, the comment was made that Mr. Thompson could never develop a project without the use of public money. Well, the reality is that quite the opposite is true. Ocean Beach Club, Beach Quarters, Ocean Air, Turtle Cay, Boardwalk Inn, Mahi Mahs, I think I'm missing a few, all have been developed with private funds and private banking, just like most of the hotels at the oceanfront. The only hotel at the oceanfront that's received any public money is 31st Street. And that was a model public-private partnership that by all measure across the city, the public has supported in retrospect. It has brought the tourism industry up. It has brought rate rooms up. It has increased the amount of occupancy year-round. It has been the success that you hoped it would be. But let me speak to the issue at hand, namely the gap financing request we have today. I'd like to just tell you a couple things for the record. First, the council's already approved gap financing for the Cavalier project. It did so in February of 2014, and it included this portion of the property. At that time, we did not have a proposed hotel, for a third hotel proposed. Our obligations with the city, which we readily accepted, were that we would build up to $205 million of product, exclusive of any residential, on that property within a 9-year period. Your records show, by the way, that people talk about how it doesn't return the money. Patty Phillips' own records show that would have brought to the city, had we stopped just there, $52.2 million in additional tax revenue over and above the incentives that were adopted, $52.2 million. So when you talk about an opportunity cost, think about where you would get a $52 million return on someone else's investment. Second point that she makes is that the gap financing would not have a great rate of return to the city if we increase this. Well, the reality is we're increasing our amount of public and private investment in this project, private money, by almost $90 million in request for $6.5 million in additional gap financing. That request reduces the percentage of, if you want to call it public money.
Mr. Nutter, your time's up.
So at any rate, I'm happy to answer any questions you have, but I hope that will help to set some of the records straight for you. Yes, ma'am.
If I do.
Yes, Ms. Henley.
Yes, ma'am.
The total value of the property.
Yes, ma'am.
Have you calculated how much real estate tax you're going to be paying?
Yes, ma'am. The total value of the property when this is all finished will be approximately $350 million. What we did is we calculated, and we broke this down in two different numbers, Ms. Henley. We calculated, because they won't let us count the residential, we calculated that the taxes on just the two oceanfront hotels would produce on an annual basis $5.5 million to the city every year after they're built. That's over and above all the incentives that you've paid heretofore. And Patty took the same numbers and she took them in a little different way. She applied them to a net present value in her figures. It's actually on page 9 of her presentation to you from the last couple of months. And the interesting thing about that is that with the $6.5 million additional investment, the tax return the city was anticipating in 2014 is double. If you look at page 9 of her report, she says in February 14, the tax return to the city would have been $52.2 million. With the additional income we're putting into this property today, Ms. Henley, the city's tax return would be $114.7 million. That's an increase of $62.5 million over and above what they were originally projecting. Now, I'd like to get an investment like that, I can tell you that. So if you're looking at the return on tax dollars, this is one of the best returns I can think of. And you're doing it while you're creating a need, not creating, but serving a need that the city does not have today. We do not have a resort conference center hotel. You heard Mr. Van Domlin testify to that repeatedly. No one is trusting his judgment. He's brand new here. He doesn't know Mr. Thompson or Mr. Lyons or any of the other players like we all do. Brand new player is telling us we need this product.
I think Mr. Moss has a question for you.
I realize you're an attorney and not a financial manager, so you make persuasive arguments. But if the market demand is so high and the return is there, then how can there be a gap in the willingness of the private sector? There's companies today are sitting on $1.8 trillion of capital in the United States today, cash. There's no shortage of cash for returns. So if the demand is there at the price point that you say that it is,
right,
then why do you need a tax expenditure, which is what a rebate is? It's a tax expenditure. If you could please explain to me why that is, that you have to have a tax expenditure when demand is there.
Right. Well, demand is something that we are investing in, first of all. Let me just say that. We believe it's there. They wouldn't even be investing $92 million of their own cash.
I don't know what you believe. Why won't the private sector lend you the money if the demand is there at your own expense?
That's what I'm going to say. Very simple. The private sector is willing to lend up to $117 million on this project. They're not holding back on the use of financing. Where the difference is, where these gaps occur, is because of several things. One, the resort and conference center activities we're putting in there, which is 34,000 square feet of conference room, which we don't have anywhere in the oceanfront, and 34,000 square feet of event space, which we don't have anywhere on the oceanfront. You put both those things in, those aren't as high income producing items. They're not a per room night item. So what it means is their per square footage cost to a lender is far less than a room night. So if people start looking for the gaps in where this financing, that's one. The second is the financiers in this market, as much as we love this market, when we go to the bank and we tell them we're going to put in X number of rooms, we will anticipate an occupancy of 72% at an average room rate of $275 an hour, $275 a night, year round. And they'll say, well, that's great, wow. Except that we don't think the market will bear that. Most of your hotels are medium grade hotels where your room rates are $150 or less a night. Why would we put you in that market? So they're not willing to lend. They're not as aggressive on that market. And that's where those gaps occur.
Okay, now if you are correct in assessing that they are incorrect in their forecast and assessment of your ability to get a price point on that room.
They're banks.
Thanks. Yeah. Why aren't the capital investors willing to put in their own equity to make up the difference to get that return you say you can get?
And they have.
So you don't need the money then?
No. We put in.
Oh, thank you very much.
We put in, all right, we've been 40%. This is the highest percentage of private capital of any project in the city's history.
I'll save my rebuttal for when I just.
I understand. Don't. I don't blame you. But I just want to let you know that they've put in $92 million of their money in this. Nowhere else in the city has done that.
Thank you.
Ms. Henley, did you have another question?
I wasn't finished with my question.
Well, thank you.
How many jobs you indicated? Yes. I think that's one of the criteria I think we look for in the gap financing. How many jobs are you creating?
It is indeed. There'll be, quite frankly, there'll be over 500 jobs created by this overall project. The important part about this is, however, that when we are applying, use the TPOF funds, for instance, we had to show how many jobs we would have over.
Please. Let the gentleman answer the question.
We had to show the number of jobs over a certain level. And the level here was the average daily wage, average wage in the city of Virginia Beach is $40,780. And that's according to the Bureau of Labor Statistics. So what we found is that we would produce, at the Cavalier alone, 81 jobs at an average salary at over $80,000. That is a very high... That is a very high number.
Please.
Very high number.
So 81 jobs over 80,000.
Excuse me. Mr. Moss, do you have another question?
Well, she's finished.
Ms. Henley, are you finished?
Well, I was. In this gap financing, we have certain criteria that you have to meet in order to be eligible, and the number of jobs is one, and your total investment, I think the requirement is $30 million, and this particular Embassy Suites is $56 million
for this particular hotel. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. Excuse me.
All right. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Mr. Brown.
I just want to call, I think when you mentioned the job for the Cavaliers, it isn't 500 jobs with the Embassy Suites specifically, if
no,
I remember correctly.
I meant for the entire project.
Okay. I just want the record to be correct that it's not the marginal benefit of the Embassy Suites.
That's correct. We meant the entire project. I apologize.
Mr. Dyer, I think, has a question.
Yeah, RJ, you know, and trust me when I say I respect Mr. Thompson. He's an innovator. He does a lot of great things. But the problem that I've had over the years with public-private partnerships, what we're being asked to do is, in essence, become partners in a hotel that's in competition with all the other hotels at the oceanfront. And you know, the other thing is, so like it or not, it's a hotel, and granted it has conference space, and in my 12 years on city council, I've never heard a council discussion about the lack of conference capabilities here really as a council priority. And what about all the other hotels that have conference space in them that we're going to be establishing competition for? So it's not a level playing field.
Let me try to address that for you, Ms. Bauer. I appreciate the question. And I have a lot of respect for you. And as you can tell by this, we've tried to have a large amount of outreach, which you always acknowledge. But at any rate, it's real clear. The average amount of meeting space in hotels is very de minimis. Even the new 27th Street Hotel you saw from the newspaper article was 1,900 square feet of total meeting space. What that means is they're designed not for the resort and conference business. They're designed for the leisure business. And that's fine. When you go to a hotel with your wife and your family, you're probably not going to have a meeting. And that's most of the hotels that are down there. And that's fine. We've got good business there. But what we're lacking, and what Norfolk just invested $80 million in, is a convention center hotel to attract businesses year-round. We don't have that. That's the problem. In fact, the Hilton is the largest one right now on the beach, 7,000 square feet in that ballroom area, compared to what we're trying to do at the Cavalier, over 34,000, to give you some idea of that difference in magnitude. So this is something that, quite frankly, they're having to invest in. They believe in, they're taking a risk on, Mr. Moss. They believe this will work, and they're going to be marketing this with your resort and conference center, your convention visitor bureau, forgive me, and well as with your overall hotels in the oceanfront. Because what we found, when people come to those conventions, not all of them will stay in the more expensive hotels. Some will stay in the others. In fact, when Brad has to put together a convention, he has to go to as many as 10 different hotels put together enough room lots and meeting space to accommodate a group. Well, if you're an event planner, you're not going to book a project, you book your hotel and your convention in 10 different hotels. So that's what this brings. That's why it's different. That's why Mr. Thompson didn't apply at Turtle Cay, 34th Street, Ocean Air. None of them have those capabilities. There are resort properties, not convention properties. That's the difference. And so. And by the way, we found when the heat of the Hilton, same thing happened. Everybody else's rates started going up, occupancy started going up, and everybody benefited from that investment. The city benefited because of its tax base. So it's really, you're investing what we're asking this program to do. And it's, again, created by the state, accepted by the city. If you meet the qualifications, why shouldn't you apply for it? And we exceed the qualifications and give you a strong tax return, in addition to providing a very needed facility that doesn't exist here. That's why we're not competing with everybody else. They don't have to work.
Same thing 100 times.
Anyway, sorry. Heather's back.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Nutter.
Yes, sir.
Next speaker.
Bruce Chisholm, do you want to speak on this item?
No, thank you.
Reed Grinham?
Thank you, sir.
Reed Grinham?
It was not denied.
I'm coming.
Good evening, City Council. My name is Reed Greenman. I live in the southern section of the city, about 3 miles from here.
I said, good evening. My name is Reed Greenman. I live in the southern section of the city, about 3 miles from here. I rise in strong opposition to this project, this gap financing. I also would like to address some comments that Mr. Nutter just made. Unbelievable. Just unbelievable. Did we not spend $309 million to build a convention center at the oceanfront to provide conference space at taxpayer expense? Did we not do that? And yet he stood here and told you there's no conference room to attack resort and conference business at the oceanfront. Seems to me I've been in that thing many, many times. So I'd like to say that is ridiculous. In addition to that, Mr. Nutter went on about all the benefits. So I'm just going to say this. I'm a free market guy, and you should be free market people, too. You should trust in the free market, not crony capitalism, as the chairwoman of the Tea Party mentioned earlier today. We're not an ATM for Bruce Thompson. So I'm going to give a short little thing, because I only have 3 minutes. Virginia Beach was started by a developer from Norfolk who saw the potential to make money. He invested all of his own money, built a train from downtown Norfolk to the oceanfront, created the Virginia Beach Development Corporation, and the entire city and all of the hotels and things that we have came from the private sector investing their own money and reaping the benefits of that. Laskin Road was built by the Laskin brothers and donated to the city to get people to their hotel on the North End. Those are the kinds of examples that you should be looking at for how we grow our businesses. And as Mr. Dyer pointed out, why are we creating competition for our other hotels at the oceanfront and the convention center that we paid for to build? It's like Everybody's gone nuts with this project. You know, free market is, and I know you're a businessman, Mr. Jones, you go out, you get your own financing, you take your own risk, and you reap the rewards. It's not your money to take out of my pocket and my home to invest in Bruce Thompson's hotel. There are 56 other hotels at the oceanfront. But you sit here and say there's no need for another hotel? I see I've got 30 seconds left. I cannot possibly communicate to you how much I encourage you to vote no on this, and at least do as one gentleman said, take a stand. Enough is enough, as another gentleman member. Please vote no on this. It is our money, it is all tax money, and we have had enough. Thank you.
Joe Belek. One more time, Joe Belek. Stanley Furman. Ken Cord. Jack Drescher. Deanna Howard.
I pass.
Gary McCollum.
Mr. Mayor, Gary McCollum. I will be very brief. 3 points. Councilman Dyer, you hit the nail on the head. If the banks see this as risky, why wouldn't the city see this as risky? First point. Second point, 500 jobs, 81 jobs at $80,000 a year doesn't pass the smell test. Having run a $1 billion company, that ratio of exempt, non-exempt, in that industry, it doesn't hold weight. I would definitely not accept that answer. And then the third issue, it's been said, but it's worth repeating. There isn't a level playing field here.
Yeah, no.
We have nothing against Bruce Thompson. Bruce Thompson is a friend of mine, but as has been said, there are 56 other hotels that are not being treated that way. And what happens, regardless of how good the financials look, the message you send by doing this deal is that this city is not open for business for anybody other than those who are politically connected to certain people. That is a bad thing to be sending. That is a bad message to be sending. And I urge you, because this really looks bad, to vote no on both of these issues. Thank you, and God bless.
Bernice Pope. George Mims. I know he left because of something. Oh, he's back?
He passed.
Ronna Marsh.
So I think a number of you have heard from other people that banks consider this risky. So if the banks are considering it risky, why doesn't the city consider this a risk? And what I did with what I put together for you was I put at the top of it, you've already had a real estate tax levy increase of 3.2% last year. So you're asking the city taxpayers to pay more. And at the same time, there are other cities across the country that have gotten into difficulties with their pension financing. And that's what I attached the 4 pages about cities that have either become bankrupt or may become bankrupt. And it's because they put their wants ahead of their needs. And I'm asking you to really look at this. We had a hurricane hit. We didn't expect that $8 million expenditure. It came out of the blue. This is not a guaranteed situation. You're putting together more competition. You're creating traffic congestion. And you're doing a number of things that put us at a higher risk. And I'm asking you to do the basics and to make sure that our pensions are funded properly for our city workers who are working so hard, and for our school district. They both had their net revenues drop, or their net income drop based on their investments, and there's no sure thing. We don't know what the economy is gonna do going forward, and it's really, really important that we look at these dollars very, very carefully, and we not commit to finance someone who could be financed in the private sector. He can go to a bank, he may have to pay a higher interest rate, but he can go to a bank, or he can find some secondary financing for this money at a higher rate. You don't have to give him a favorable rate and do this bond deal, which, if I heard the director correctly, it's going to take 14 to 15 years to get the money paid back to us. To me, that is not a good deal for the citizens and for the workers of the city who need to be sure that their pensions are well taken care of. So I ask you not to do this. I ask you to realize that we don't need the additional congestion on the streets, and that the taxpayers, you know, are already paying more, and they don't need this risk. So thank you very much.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Go ahead.
Barbara, go right
ahead.
I haven't had time to look at this yet, but I'm going to look at it.
Okay, that's Mr.
But wouldn't it be a fair statement to say that most of the cities that have entered bankruptcy due to pension liabilities have been cities that have declining populations and a declining tax base?
I don't believe so, and that's why I provided you all the detailed information on the 20 cities. And I think what it is it's about financial mismanagement. It's about poor choices.
And wouldn't you agree that the city of Virginia Beach, rated as a AAA bond credit rating, would not be considered
a fiscal credit rating now? But there have been financial firms that have invested. The city of Orange County invested in AAA rated bonds that actually they had one of the biggest debacles ever, because those bonds were CMOs and they were very poor tranches, and they declared bankruptcy back in the 90s. So what you think we have now may not be here in a year or 5 years or 10 years, and I'm asking you to be prudent on every one of these decisions, because I think $6.5 million is a lot of money, and that's about what you earned from raising the taxes by 3.2% on the property taxes. So it sounds small, but it really is big, and I think it can be raised by the private sector. So, you know, you can decide what you want about these other cities and communities. I don't want to get there. That's why I came and spoke, and that's why I brought up the fact that we need to be prudent on every decision.
Thank you.
Are you through, Mr. Davenport?
I'm finished.
Ms. Henley?
I'm very concerned that people leave here thinking that we have problems with our pension funding, and so I would ask either the city manager, or if Patty is still here, can you address how we are addressing our pensions, because we've been dealing with it quite heftily for a while, and where we are with this.
I think Patty, are you here? She's departed. Our pensions are established by VRS. City employees all belong to the Virginia retirement system. The percentages that we apply to our fully burdened rates and our payroll are established on an annual basis, and we program those to meet those standards. Probably one of the best managed pension funds in the nation. So I would encourage you just to look at that. The form that you gave us is really looking at the Virginia Beach City Public Schools, and we'll look deep into that. But I can tell you that the superintendent and the school board, they take direction from the state pension that provides the retirement benefits for the school teachers in the city.
Page I gave you, Mr. Hanson, sorry to interrupt you, was city. I gave you the city. There's another page. Page 129 is a school board. And what I was referring to, the fact that if you're expecting the pensions to be sustaining based on investment dollars, and the investment markets don't perform the way you think they're going to perform, then, you know, you have to have some backup plans. And so, and it's really hard, because all you give in the CAFR is fiscal year 15. We are now in 17. So there's a one-year delay in this. So I, as a citizen, can't really look at this and know what happened last year, although we're in March of another year. So
I would just suggest that we have Ms. Phillips answer your questions,
great,
because she knows that CAFR backwards and forwards,
and
as
I
do her people,
no,
and I'll be glad to have her call you and set up a meeting if you'll leave your information with
me. I'm happy to do that.
Okay, thank you.
I'm sure we'll help.
I know we want to get on. All these people are waiting for
Mr. Moss. You have.
Well, I just want to clarify, the city's outstanding deficit is just under $400 million, which we amortize over 30 years and make annual payments to make it up. The school board's debt deficit, as you want to call it, unfunded liabilities, over 800, and I think it's 850 something million dollars. And that's also amortized over 30 years, which we have to make additional payments each and every year. It probably cost us 3 to 4 cents on the real estate tax base to make those supplemental payments to make up for the actuarial deficiencies of those funds. And if you look at the bond prospectus that we issue, all that stuff is laid out in there. but we are physically sound, we are making the payment, but they are represent an opportunity cost to the taxpayers.
Next speaker.
Jimmy Frost. I think he left too.
No, I ain't got nothing to say.
That's all, Your Honor.
That's all the speakers on that item. All right. We will now entertain a motion on item three, which is the ordinance to amend ORD 3326E to increase the gap financing authorization rate of the Cavalier restoration and authorize other actions consistent with the state tourism development financing program. Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion to approve.
Second.
There's a motion and a second. Any discussion?
Mr. Vice Mayor, I'd like to make a substitute motion for indefinite deferral.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right. First thing we will do is discuss the substitute motion. Any discussion on the substitute motion? Yes, Mr. Dyer.
Yeah, thank you. I think we have to be intellectually honest on this, and I think we have to make two assumptions going forward. Number one, I think there is a tremendous amount of ambiguity out there about what gap financing is, what it can and can't do, and things of that nature. I think it bears further discussion so the public understands things better and that we understand things better. And once again, my concern, going forward, yes, the term perception has been used here quite a bit. And there's an underlying assumption, there's, lack of trust, there's a lack of understanding between us, between government, between developers, and, the public at large, that I really think that we have to, go forward. And I think the other thing that we really have to be intellectually honest and discussed, there is a tremendous perception of a lack level playing field here in the city that we really have to address in a very bold and aggressive manner. And the thing is about this thing of about a level playing field and the perception that certain people get certain things, but other people don't get certain things. Recently, our Process Improvement Task Force, we did a study examining the barriers to small business startup and expansion. And we found across the board there were a lot of frustrations in dealing with the city and, trying to do business. And, we're bending over backwards in a lot of ways to try to improve things, but we're not quite there yet. So I think one of the things that we have to do, what I would like to do, and I have been requested to do, Shannon Kane and I work together with the Minority Business Council and the Human Rights Commission. And the point is that we have to really do a better job to aggressively create a culture of inclusion and opportunity for everybody in the city of Virginia Beach, and people feel that way. And that being said, we're going to ask our process improvement team to put together a task force to take a serious look on how we can better serve the public by creating that equal playing field that are going to satisfy not only the minority members, the small businesses, the women, the veterans, the disabled, but everybody in this town. And I just think, it's better right now to promote the understanding if we would, in fact, just defer it. Promote this bridge of understanding that we really have to do. And thank you, Mr. Vice Mayor.
Mr. Davenport.
Councilman Dyer, there's a couple of things that concern me there, and one of them is the fact about the perception. I think that we have to be impartial judges up here and not look at the people behind the projects, but look at the projects based on their merits. And what I would say to you is that if you are I guess, favorable to making sure that we have a level playing field, would you support a full disparity study without doing it in three phases?
We already approved and moved forward on a disparity study. And the other thing is, Mr.
In three phases, and I didn't give up the floor.
Hold on. Let Mr. Davenport finish. And then.
So the disparity study that we have approved is done in three phases, and I would ask you again, would you consider removing the three phases if you're really interested in a level playing field?
No, Mr. Davenport, let me explain to you one thing, that a disparity study will not fix the problem here at hand. This is a totally different issue. The point is the disparity study that we are going to conduct is going to be a comprehensive disparity study. That is a sidebar issue. What we are discussing right now is a level playing field for every business in the city of Virginia Beach, a level playing field for everybody. Thank you.
Any more discussion on this substitute motion? Ms. Henley?
The thing that is so disturbing is that so much misinformation gets printed and discussed and thrown around, and nobody knows who to believe. And then, yes, we do create these perceptions. And I don't know how we overcome the perceptions. That just has to be up to each individual person. I think what something that maybe, I'm not sure which of these gentlemen just said, was a level playing field. And I think the important thing is that we do, that people understand that we do have various programs for different groups of levels of businesses that may be qualified, because we have our EDIP, which I believe was maybe a Mr. Moss proposal way back when you were on the council in the 90s.
1987.
And that's a lot of businesses come in and they get that economic funding that the Development Authority is able to pass out. So we do things for many different businesses. This particular one, which is a program that was developed by the state and the General Assembly, has other parameters. But I know in the time that I've been on the council, which is a good while, I think we have had this entire time as one of our goals to increase our commercial tax base so that we're not as heavily dependent on the residential. And if we're going to increase our commercial tax base, we have to try to attract investors to do business and invest in the city and develop the commercial opportunities. And then they pay all that real estate and the business personal property and all of that other. And I just hope that, you know, folks begin to look at this from a standpoint of how businesses and investors, quote, developers, invest in our city and then create the tax base that allows us to have that reliance more so than the residential. We seem to not be able to budge off that residential. But it's very important that people kind of listen with an open mind. And I really have to say that I appreciate so much the comments that were made by the Oceans Condominium President, Homeowners Association, and the North Virginia Beach Civic League President, that because these two organizations have been studying this thing for this particular proposal, this project, for a couple of years now, and are thoroughly aware of what it is, and they both came down and said, we recommend approval because we really know what's going on here. And, you know, if I thought delaying it would help, I would be all for it. But, you know, we have to understand that this is not the city giving them a loan. It is not the city giving them a check. It's an opportunity that they have to get a rebate on 1% of the sales tax that would be coming to the city to help with this financing. It's money that would not even be coming to the city if this building and this business were not there. So it's what we call but-for taxes. But for this opportunity, this business, we wouldn't have the tax anyway. So the opportunity cost is not that we would have the money to spend on something else. We wouldn't have the money unless they are existing. And so all of the other taxes that they're going to be generating will come to the city to do all these other things that we need to do. The real estate tax they're going to pay, the personal business personal property tax they're going to pay, the hotel room tax they're going to pay, the meal tax they're going to collect. All those other taxes we will get, and that will help us finance these other things that we do need. It's kind of frustrating that we can't all individually sit down and go over all of this. Difficult for us to, I think, come to any conclusions when we have to look at all of the misinformation that seems to be the thing that folks would rather listen to.
Yes, Mr. Wall.
Well, I'd like to address some misinformation because I just heard some.
Okay. We'll debate.
I remember being on the stage at King's Grant Elementary. This is in 1986. Linwood Branch was there, Miss Emily was there, Nancy Parker was there, Walt Varga was there, and the big issue was, how do we change and shift the real estate tax base from residential to commercial? And you remember what it was back then? It was 80-20.
80-20.
We haven't made much movement. Now, during that ensuing 31 years now almost, we've had every big government subsidy giveaway B-poll tax for some people, give away free land to people, make deals, and over all that government intrusion to pick the winners and losers in the marketplace, the impact has been negligible. Doesn't mean the efforts weren't good, but the strategy didn't pay off because it didn't change the balance. And why? The more government intrudes in the marketplace, those very subsidies, whether they be direct or tax expenditures, cause the inefficient allocation of capital, and you sub-optimize growth, and you drive out people who might come, but who won't come because they can't compete with the people we pick to succeed. And that has an impact, a crowding out effect. So when you look at the strategy, it has not paid off. So maybe it's time to get a new strategy. Now, the other point that people talk about, but the not for taxes. No one has yet presented, and I haven't seen the empirical analysis or validated, that says if they only went with what they could get financing for, and lo and behold, the people have to go have their convention at the convention center, what is really the marginal difference in revenue that property doesn't generate? Because that's really all you're buying, if you believe that's our role. You're only buying the marginal revenue, not the revenue you would get if they built some other project, which you don't know what that is, because why? You're crowding out. You're also making the assumption that all those revenues would not have been spent somewhere else. But you may recall, and I'm sure many of you do, when Patty Phillips gave her first presentation in the informal conference room about the original deal, she said in the first 5 years, 75% of the revenues would be cannibalization. That's a nice word for meaning dollars that would have been spent somewhere else in Virginia Beach that are now being spent at this location. I didn't make those numbers up. That's her numbers. So I think you really have to understand, but that's assuming that you buy into the principle, which I'll talk about later, that it's the fundamental role of government to be in the marketplace to start with. This is like getting the evidence and saying, well, don't forget I didn't have the search warrant. Let's just not ignore the fundamental principle I'm violating. Let's just look at the goodies at the end. But I think you have to really look at that much more holistically. And like you said, it's not 500 jobs at the embassy suites. It's something different. I just went online. He's great about these smartphones. They can make you smarter than you really are. And I went up and looked at what jobs pay at the embassy suites. And you start looking at them, it's $17.95, it's $13.10. I mean, you can start looking. So the data doesn't quite match up. Maybe there's a difference. But my point being is, once again, not the role of government. And when it came to pay for radios for the ambulances, what did we have to do? Did that come from? No, 25-cent cigarette tax. When it came time to buy apparatuses, breathing apparatus for firefighters, did that come out of this growth tourism? No, 40-cent increase on the personal property tax. Now, if tonight we had a combined motion that we're approving this deal, and because it's so fabulous, we're reducing the real estate tax 2 cents, we probably would have a lot of people clamoring, but other night, we couldn't even reduce taxes for a project that went away.
So the message that we are sending is not backed up by the empirical facts of our performance for our strategy. And that's just the facts. I mean, it's unemotional about it, but it hasn't changed the balance of who pays the bill. But it doesn't come back to the fundamental principle is this something that government should be doing at all? And just because we adopt it, we're not obligated to do it.
Councilman Moss, as usual, I thought your comments were very well spoken, and I have the greatest respect for Councilman Moss. We disagree philosophically on the role of government and public-private partnerships. He would tell you that they don't work. The fact is that they're used in every city in the United States. And if we put Mr. Moss's, theories into actuality, it would be ruinous for the city of Virginia Beach. Now, I wanted to point out something that Mr. Moss brought up about picking winners and losers. In 2011, Colgate et al. And the Dissentine Group started down a process of dissolution of assets. And for those of you who aren't familiar, the Dissentine Group was the group that owned the Cavalier Hotel. A receiver was appointed by the court, and a bidding process was started. It was advertised in the Wall Street Journal and every publication in real estate that there is. The court, not the city of Virginia Beach, picked the Cavalier Associates Group. So that's one point that we did not pick this group, and I think you would agree with that. The court system picked this group. Another fact that I think that is important is, by right, this property was zoned for over 3,000 residential units, 21 acres, 3,000 residential units. What would have happened if we had built 3,000 residential units there? Well, first thing, and this is something that, again, Mr. Moss and I disagree on, the Cavalier Hotel would have been demolished, which we could have a debate on whether or not that was the right thing. However, I believe that it would have been a tragedy for us to lose the most iconic building in Hampton Roads. My family's been in Prince Anne County for a long time. What I can tell you is there are not many iconic buildings in the city of Virginia Beach. This is certainly the most iconic. With the developer who was picked, they agreed to save the Cavalier Hotel, which I think is a great asset for future generations. Part of doing that was downzoning the property. So now, as opposed to having 3,000 residential units there, we're going to have 500 hotel rooms and 84 residences there. So I think, again, that's a win for the city of Virginia Beach. When you look at just what Councilwoman Henley was talking about, we have to continue to expand our tax base. When Ms. Marsh was talking about the pension liabilities and the cities who have gone bankrupt because they aren't able to keep up with the obligations, the reason that they weren't able to keep up is they had a shrinking tax base that wasn't able to grow, that didn't have new investment. And as a result, taxes in those cities that went bankrupt went way up. City services went way down, and that's why we have to bring new investment into this city. And so with that, I think that we should not approve the substitute motion and approve the original motion.
No. All right. Any further comment? We'll vote on the substitute motion. The vote's open.
By a vote of 5-3, you have defeated the motion, the substitute motion.
All right, now we'll go to the next item. We have to vote on the original motion. Any comments or discussion on the original motion?
I just want to make a brief statement. I don't want to repeat what I said before. There is much that could be said on the motion before us, none of which is likely to persuade the votes cast by my peers. The public's comments, you're the owners and the stockholders of the city. If you are on record as to your position, and the public who is watching or watching later can make their own judgments as to the votes that are cast. My peers work for you, they don't work for me, and I don't comment on their specific votes. I respect how they cast their votes. Therefore, my votes are focused on the reasons of my vote in the simplest of terms and leaving that assessment to you. It's no secret, I'm a big believer in limited government, and I'm a big believer in free market and the principles of capitalism. I can't believe that how John D. Rockefeller ever made it without a subsidy. I believe that it is not the role of government to create an unlevel playing field in the economic marketplace. And when we do, overall, we tend to suppress long-term economic growth, and that's the empirical evidence. Direct subsidies and direct tax expenditures inherently incentivize the inefficient allocation of capital and drive bad behavior. I believe it is not the role of government to be an active partner in the construction of a specific hotel or any hotel. We should focus on the core things that government does well and do those things well. For the reasons stated in the applications of this very fundamental principle, which has been lost in all the numbers and the profit and spend, is the ends are not justified by the means. Everyone wants this gentleman to be successful, absolutely, but not at the sacrifice of the core basic principles on which this country was founded, which we're supposed to act on, and which I believe my oath of office compels me to do.
Any further discussion?
I'd just like to state for the record, I disagree with Mr. Moss on this.
Any further discussion?
Well, Ms. Henry. I would just say that, you know, I hope that all of this controversy doesn't discourage investors and investors to apply for the incentives that we do have with our EDIP program and with this program and any others that we have. You know, this one is involves a rebate of, as I said, 1% of the sales tax collected only on this site. We've got another public-private partnership we're looking at now where we will be rebating every single penny of every single tax that they collect. That's going too far in my book, but I'm the only one who seemed to think that. Anyway, these other things that we got on, these other topics, you know, like the disparity study and the pensions and the level playing field, they're all things that we do need to talk about, and I really hope that we will continue in those areas to really try to all understand what's going on. But I think this particular application deals with this particular issue, and these other, I think Mr. Dyer called them sidebar issues, you know, confuse it. This application has gone through the process. It certainly does meet the parameters. It exceeds the parameters. And I'm not looking at the individual other than to know that it's somebody who does a good job. It's not a personal thing. It's does the application meet the parameters that's required here? They meet it and they exceed it, and I'll be voting for it.
All right. We will now vote on the original motion, which is to approve item 3. Votes open.
By a vote of 5-3, you have approved or adopted the main motion to approve.
Next item is the resolution to authorize the city manager to A, apply for a transportation partnership opportunity fund grant, rate the partial realignment of Atlantic Avenue, and B, petition the Commonwealth of Virginia Transportation Board to transfer certain real property to the city of Virginia Beach. Do we have any speakers?
Well, I'll call the same ones I did before since I don't know who's on what.
Okay.
R.J. Nutter.
Oh, great. Thanks.
Please.
Thank you very much. Thank you again, ladies and gentlemen. And I know it's late. Many of us have repeated many of the points we wanted to make earlier in the day. So
I
will do my best, miss. But I wanted to say on this item, this is the Atlantic Avenue issue. And we have had more outreach on this issue than any in recent memory. My client, with me in some cases, without me in many cases, has met with the North End Civic League, Ocean Hills Civic League, the Oceans Condominiums, Galilee Church, Cavalier Shores, the Prince Anne Country Club Board, and held a facility, a meeting at the convention in December of this past year. Significantly to me, the people who are most directly affected, who those live right by it, have come and spoke this evening in favor. Several others could not come. Judge Allcamp, I'm sorry, couldn't be here today from Ocean Hills. But all of those civic leagues came out, and Ocean Hills did, North End Civic League, and even the Oceans, which took quite a few meetings, quite frankly, with their membership to have them understand it. One thing I would like to correct in the record from one of the first speakers on this item, and that was that somehow we were going to have access via the cul-de-sac to the MC Suites Hotel. The only access the city is allowing us, and the only access we have sought, is for delivery vehicles only. We made it perfectly clear the main access for the both hotels on the oceanfront will be at one location, and that's the location that this realignment will create. We will be spending, I know they don't want to hear this, but we'll be spending over $2 million in improvements within that area to make it look really nice, like you're arriving at a major first-class resort. So I will tell you that we've had a lot of outreach, that the people most affected are here today in support of it. And I'd also tell you that the traffic study we did, one of the things that they didn't mention, we had to assume that all these hotels were at 100% occupancy and we had conventions going on at the facility. So if you're able to do that, which we did, and show that your level of service at those intersections is levels B and C, and for those you know, council members, B and C levels of service at intersections is almost unheard of in the city. To do that is just remarkable, and that's based upon 100% occupancy of all those facilities. So I submit to you that the proposal makes perfect sense from a traffic perspective. It solves the traffic problem that the existing alignment will create, not by it didn't intend to create it, but just the nature of how the road is aligned and how those hotels are aligned. So to avoid that, we're willing to spend extra money. We don't get one extra room. We don't get one extra room night, nothing. We're going to be spending $2 million of the developer's money to make this look first class and simulate the original hotel, Cavalier Hotel lawn system. So I would urge you to support it. We've had lots of meetings. We've done lots of studies. Your staff supports it, and we would urge your support as well. Thank you, Mr. Vice Mayor.
Thank you. Next speaker.
Bruce Chisholm.
Yes.
I just wanted to make the observation that the two speakers that were recognized as being aware of what was going on and up to date left out a whole lot of people in this room who have been following this closely.
Microphone.
Thank you. I think I was just corrected as well on the entrance into the embassy suites off the cul-de-sac is not going to be in effect. Mr. Nutter?
That's correct.
So no cars are going through that cul-de-sac?
Delivery vehicles only into that hotel. No, all the guests arrive through the main entrance, not through that cul-de-sac.
Main entrance on the landing?
Cabin. Yes, sir. They don't come in through that cul-de-sac.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Reed Grenham. Reed Grenham.
I'm coming. Good evening, City Council. My name is Reed Greenman, resident, as I said, south side of the city. Unlike what Mr. Nutter, who is representing Mr. Thompson, told you, I attended numerous events about this issue, and I read voluminous amounts of information because I'm an analyst, and that's what I do. So to insinuate that our objections in the general public, the taxpayers who pay for these things, are not knowledgeable about the issue, and although you are my council representative, Barbara Henley, and I love you dearly, you know, you made a lot of assertions about sort of perceptions and wrong information. It's not that we object to this because we're not informed. We object to it because it's the wrong thing to do. So in the case of this traffic study and these things, I just couldn't believe the chutzpah of both, unfortunately, my city manager who was speaking at that convention center discussion of this project, and Mr. Thompson. And I took detailed notes and paid close attention to what he was talking about with this proposal. I really don't think, and this is the thing, you heard it tonight. You said that what we're going to do is take the property from VDOT and transfer it to the city. So this 80 parking lot for valet parking for this new hotel that's going to compete with all the other hotels isn't actually going on the tax roll. It's going to be city property, so you can kind of keep the title to that. I'm just, it blows my mind that you would be doing this. If Mr. Thompson wants to build a hotel, great. Invest his own money, pay for it in himself. But to come to you and say, I want to close a public street, and I want to build valet parking for myself, and I want to do all of these things along with this project, and ask you to close a public street for him, I'm stunned. And you've already voted, so I already see that you're supporting this, and I listened to your comments, Mr. Davenport, and I see what your case is. Mr. Moss made a compelling case we shouldn't be doing this in the first place. So let's not compound a bad decision with yet another one. Let's put this right to the point. This is about valet parking for a hotel at the oceanfront. And you're actually going to close public streets, spend $2.5 million of transportation money that should be spent elsewhere on higher priorities, to give a developer a special privilege that nobody else has. It's nuts. So anyway, maybe you could redeem yourself. Although you've already voted for the rest of this, vote no on this. Think of the perception that you're giving people, Barbara. Thank you.
Joe Bilek. Joe Bilek. Stanley Furman. Ken Cord. Jack Drescher.
I've spoken, Madam Clerk. Thank you.
Diana Howard. Gary McCollum.
Wait.
Diana.
There is nothing unique, special, or new about another hotel at the oceanfront. It is very selfish of Mr. Thompson to think that he should close down an entire street just for his benefit, and I cannot believe that you would misuse our transportation funds for this purpose and our city manager's time to hawk on his behalf. I cannot believe this. Please vote no.
Gary McCollum.
I know the hour is late. Again, I urge you to vote no on this issue. Councilman Henley, you mentioned the organizations that stood here and said that they were informed and they are supporting this. I may have been born at night, but not last night. I know some of the people on those boards, and I'm not going to make any accusations, but this is part of the problem that we have here in Virginia Beach. And you know exactly what I'm talking about. This is wrong, what we're doing. Last point I'll make, Mr. Dyer. Columbus, Ohio did a disparity study. They issued the RFP, I believe, October 1st of 2016, so this is very recent. They actually let the contract the end of December 2016. That RFP was a half a page in length. Let me repeat that. It was one half page in length. The RFP that you just talked about, which Councilman Davenport challenged you to do a full disparity study, is 39 pages long, full of conditions, three parts, all kinds of restrictions and everything else. Do the study so that we can get rid of this perception that this is not a level playing field in Virginia Beach. Thank you and God bless you.
Bernice Pope. Bernice Pope, George Manns,
Vice Mayor Jones, members of council, my name is E. George Manns, represent the SeaTac community.
I take exception to the issue of every time the citizens who have been many oftentimes victims is brushed off as being a mere perception. No disrespect, Ms. Henley, greatest respect for you. But when citizens have been the victims, it is no longer perception. And any reasonable observer to how business is conducted in this beach and on that oceanfront, no ma'am, it's not just perception. For example, I stood there on the wall and I was amazed to hear that North Beach Civic League and the other Civic League there had such free information flowing to them at such long period of times and at such degree from city staff. SeaTac has not had that privilege. It's not a perception. I've been president 8 years. All of the communities are not treated the same. Businesses are not treated the same. It is a fact, not a mere perception. For those of us who are on the disadvantaged side, all due respects to the fine lady, Ms. Henley.
Jimmy Frost. Jimmy Frost.
I ain't speaking of this. I done spoke.
Your Honor, that's all that's speaking.
All right. The item we item that we're on is the resolution to authorize city manager A, apply for Transportation Partnership Opportunity Fund grant, raise the partial realignment of Atlantic Avenue, and B, petition for the Commonwealth Virginia Transportation Board to transfer certain real property to the City of Virginia Beach. May I have a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Motion's been made and second. Is there any discussion? Mr. Moss.
Just one point I just want to share with the audience. This is, as you heard the city staff say, that they understood that the city council wasn't willing to spend our local money on $2.5 million because we didn't think it was either one, worth it, or two, politically acceptable. But yet we're going to ask the governor to give us state money for a project we wouldn't use local money for. Now, during the informal session last week, I asked a very fundamental question for a very important reason. I asked the staff, is the project, which has now been approved, predicated on the closure, rerouting, however you want to phrase it, of Atlantic Avenue? And the answer was clearly no. It is not predicated on that closure, on the cul-de-sac. Thought that was very important. Because when you look at the opportunity grant that we're applying for, it says that one of the preconditions is it is necessary to consummate a development project. Well, clearly in this case, it wasn't, because there is no nexus between the two. So I wrote a letter to the governor telling him that I feel all of us as elected officials have a fiduciary responsibility. And I didn't think the state should be spending $2.5 million on something for a project in our community when the local governing body who directly benefits from it isn't willing to do it. So I see a disconnect between voting for the project and voting for this vote tonight and then not willing to vote for the $2.5 million, but expect another body of government statewide to give us a grant under conditions we can't meet. So I just want people to contemplate that as this vote takes place, just how this looks, and follow the logic, and it's hard to connect the dots.
Anybody else? Ms. Henley?
I do. It's probably better to say nothing, because then you don't risk being misunderstood in what you say. And if anyone thought that I was saying that you don't know what you're talking about, that wasn't what I was saying at all. What I said was that I appreciated the people who are most affected, these civic leagues that are living right there, and all the time that they had spent, and I appreciated their perception. And, you know, there's that word perception. And I think this is something clearly we have to work on, but, you know, we also have to understand that just because somebody has a different opinion than what we have, it doesn't make one or the other wrong. That's one of those things that we're allowed to have, is difference of opinions, and then we can still respect each other. And when we all look at the information and we come to a different opinion, that's supposed to be okay. And I think that's perhaps what we have. And so I certainly am not going to denigrate anyone who has an opinion different from mine. But my feeling is, of course, the important thing is that we put forth the facts. And I have said, and I am voting based on this, that my vote on this will depend on which way it makes for a safer, better traffic flow. And the report that we got from our traffic studies was that if they use the by right only, that it's going to cause more congestion on Atlantic Avenue and a greater difficulty with the traffic moving there, because it's going to stack up at certain times when those conferences are going to leave. So it's on the basis of the safety, and local government's purpose is to provide for the health, safety, and welfare of our citizens. And so for the safety of the people who will be using that, clearly this realignment it has been judged by the traffic officials to be the safer alignment.
Any further discussion? If not, the vote is open.
By a vote of 5-3, you have adopted the application for Atlantic Avenue.
Madam Clerk, would you please note that Mayor Sessoms and Councilman Earn left the building. Chambers during the conversation?
Yes, Your Honor.
Consideration and abstained on both item 3 and 4.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Vice Mayor, for doing a great job. We'll now go to ordinance number 10 to appropriate $14,976,969 of the multimodal fund regarding the Norfolk Southern right-of-way acquisition refund account. Call the speaker. One speaker, please.
Reed Grenham.
We welcome you tonight, sir.
Yes, good evening, Mayor, and rest of the City Council. Welcome back. Well, this issue is a little less contentious than what we've had to deal with tonight, so my remarks are a little more on this. I'm a member of the Virginia Beach Tea Party, which stands for Taxed Enough Already. And as Mr. Moss mentioned, you had the opportunity 4 months ago, tomorrow, we told you no, don't build light rail, but you continue to collect taxes and fees. And so Mr. Moss was kind enough to put together two resolutions. Those resolutions were to ask you to cease and desist with the taxes and to put the money into a particular fund. I'm a little odds with understanding the differences between the actual language of the resolution that you passed, the way it was worded on your website, and what it is in the city agenda don't seem to actually match. So let me kind of be clear of what we were expecting versus what you're doing. Now, first of all, I understood that there's between $27 million and $31 million that have been collected from the extra taxes and fees that were collected for light rail, yet you're only going to move $14.9 million into the account. Further, while Mr. Moss talks about in his resolution that you passed putting the information from the Multimodal Transportation Fund into the Norfolk Southern Right-of-Way Acquisition Fund so that it could be repaid in a lump sum manner, he talks about the disbursements from the account not exceeding $25 million without you guys voting on it. This is the resolution. Yet, in your city council agenda, it says the city has directed $25 million to be reserved in the aforementioned account to repay the obligations. I want to make clear, all the money that you've collected should be in that account, if it's $27 or $31 million, and as you continue to collect the taxes and fees for light rail, not limited to $25 million. I don't think that you should have continued the taxes and fees after you were told no by your voters. And when we came to you and asked you to cease and desist, and Mr. Davenport, you made a substitute motion to Mr. Moss's motion, which, by the way, we were unable to address as citizens because, of course, That substitute motion isn't advertised in advance of the council, so I couldn't address his substitute motion, which is not really the way to do what you're doing. This is a public meeting to hear from us. A, you should have ceased and desist after we told you no. But now that we've done it, take the money, pay off the balance of what we owe, and keep that money in a special account. The taxpayers gave you, the Tea Party of Virginia Beach gave you a resolution. It addressed SGAs and stopping all funding. Please take a look at that resolution and do what we asked you to do at the polls. Stop with the light rail, buy off the right-of-way, and then come back to us with a plan that makes
sense.
Thank
you very much for your comments. Next speaker, please.
That's it.
Do I have a motion?
I move for its adoption, but I would like to explain. I mean, it's a little tricky in the body of the resolution. Wasn't meant to be tricky, but all the money has been moved. This is just the part that was appropriated in 16 that has to be reappropriated into this account, but the account will have all the money collected to date will be in that refund account. And it does require for each and every disbursement that the council vote. It's not under $25 million. It's for each and every disbursement. We anticipate we might have to pay as much as $25 million, $20 million to the state, and potentially $5 million to the Fed. But the money is there. I sat down and made sure that was true. So,
got a motion to have a second?
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? Call for the question, please. Thank you.
By a vote of 10-0 with Mrs. Kane absent, you have adopted the resolution.
We're good to planning item number four, the Bunny Hutch Inc. and Justin M. Fella for a conditional use permit regarding wildlife rehabilitation and animal shelter at 1165 Jensen Drive. This was on consent, if you recall, council. How many speakers do we have?
Two.
Are they in favor or against?
One's in favor and one is, I don't know. Mr. Mims, I don't know what it is.
Okay, well, call the applicant first, please.
Dr. Andrew Maxwell.
We welcome you tonight, I think.
We got the rabbit.
Yeah.
The only one of his kind in the United States. He is currently also the largest bunny in the United States. And he'll be receiving a commendation from the mayor to be the official Easter bunny to promote our rescues. Please adopt, don't shop, do not get live animals as gifts. And there's a chocolate challenge, and Junior's going to be, of course, providing you with the gift of his favorite treat, which is goldfish crackers.
Oh. Okay. Thank you.
That is so cute. All right. My son's not here.
Okay. Ma'am, this was on consent. I gather someone in opposition. You have the right to talk after the opposition if you would just wait.
Right.
Okay, please.
Hey, George Mims.
Mr. Mims, you have up to 10 minutes representing the Civic League in a planning item if you so desire.
Thank you, Master. And again, my name is E. George Mims, president of the 109-year-old SeaTac community, Civic League, and the 400-year-old oldest community in Beach District number 6. I rise in opposition on and offer two options. Number one, deny, which that probably won't be the case, and the alternative. I asked in advance Mr. Barry Frankenfield if he would add a restriction to the conditional use. I have no problem with a bunny at all. I don't think anybody would. Cute little fella. But this is what I have a problem with. I read it and I understood it to say wild and exotic animal shelter. I got a problem on the wild side. And the problem I have, let me give you an example. I am not and does not purport to be a scientist, zoologist, or anything of that nature. But when you say wow, that leaves the door wide open. The concern of the SeaTac Board of Directors is this. If you allow it, put some strict restrictions in there. Because if you take, for example, hypothetically, a wild raccoon or any other kind of wild animal, there's nothing wrong with trying to help them medically or rehabilitate them or whatever. The problem I have is, how do you handle putting them back in the wild? This place does not have enough space. It's got probably 4 feet of grass. It's not 25 acres of open space down the county where it would be similar to wild. And I believe, based on my research, that if you have a wild animal, before you put them back in the wild, you are supposed to hold them in an area that is similar to the wild. Because if you have them around cars, people, things that are urban, that formerly wild animal may not be as wild as it was. And depending on where you release it, and I don't think no member of council want anybody releasing wild animals close to your home, surely we don't want it in SeaTac. That animal will be more inclined to go around cars or people because they've lost the sense of shyness from them. That is the problem we have. The second would be dangerous. If there's any species that's venomous, dangerous to a human, we would ask that it be restricted. You cannot bring it there under no circumstances. Why? Because the children are right next door at the rec center. Residents are there. And let the record reflect. The Planning Commission records show that they did not send any notice to the SeaTac community, the citizens. The operator of the facility stated in the Planning Commission that she talked to SeaTac. No, she did not. She went next door and talked to city employees at the SeaTac Rec Center. That's not the citizens. That's not the lifelong residents. So the whole thing in a nutshell, we ask that if you do decide to approve this, that you give some solid protection against any dangerous, venomous type animals, and some restriction, however, would be that if it is a wild animal, that it not be one that would need to be placed somewhere where they got plenty of space around wildness to get ready to go back in the wild. That is our concern, is public safety, public safety, public safety. Any questions?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Jimmy Frost.
Jimmy, we welcome you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I can speak to this issue and Mr. Min's concerns. A lot of the wild animals that I'm sure he would be concerned about are things like exotic cats and things along that nature. You have to have a federal permit to house and transport those animals. Secondly, there is already a lot of wildlife down at the beachfront. We have coyotes, we have foxes, we have raccoons, we have possums, and we have feral cats pretty much everywhere. Foxes and raccoons are also very high incident carriers of rabies. Okay, so these dangers are already there. But I see this as something that could really be of benefit to the SeaTac community, because if you've ever seen my phone here, that's a picture of my cat Zoe. Okay, I've had her about 13 years now. And when I first got her, I was in a really bad marriage and a job I didn't care for. And I was either going to adopt a cat or I was going to blow my brains out. I was that unhappy. And that, you know, having this cat kind of changed my life and sent it off in a different direction. So I think that Mr. Min's community could really benefit from having something like this, because, I mean, I was fascinated when I saw this animal. I think maybe a lot of the kids down there in SeaTac might be too. And I would certainly, you know, respect his wishes that if they had any kind of, you know, strange or exotic animal, you know, such as poisonous snakes, which again, you need to have federal permits for, and I doubt that the federal government would grant those permits in such close proximity to the rec center. But that said, that's just an observation. Mr. Min speaks on behalf of the SeaTac community, and that's just the insight that I have to offer on wild and exotic animals.
Thank you for your comments. Ma'am? You heard the concerns raised.
One of the issues that I don't think he understands is all of the animals that we take in are already taken in by every shelter in every city in the United States. What we're attempting to do is to assist all of the shelters in Hampton Roads by taking in those animals who have a high mortality rate in those shelters who have absolutely no professionals or experts to be able to deal with them. We took in on Valentine's Day a 5-foot green iguana from Peninsula Regional SPCA. They have another 2-foot I don't have room for. We've been currently working with the economic development because I wish to stay in Virginia Beach. I really like it here. I live in the community, and economic development and donors in the community have reached out to us. Channel 3 is having us come on Coast Live once a month to bring exotic adoptables. We have experts. I'm a retired pathologist. I'm not a veterinarian. So if it's something past my expertise, the Pet Care Center Veterinary Hospital has reached out to us and will assist us in caring for animals that we feel as zookeepers and professionals, even though it's your American right to own, that we often do not feel you have the ability to care for them properly. Hence why I have a 5-foot iguana. Someone bought it at a cash-only expo and kept it in their house for years. He's severely malnourished and needs assistance that only my herpetologist and the vets and the nutritionists and interns we have from pre-vet programs from William & Mary through NC State. There isn't any federal permit, city or state, that I haven't sought after. We're a USDA inspected rescue, like all rescues in the United States. We follow AZA guidelines, the highest letter of cleanliness in the world. All of our people have background checks and have signed letters of responsibility to promote the mission of all life matters. Any questions? Oh, and we won't ever have venomous snakes. I'm too accident prone.
Well, it does say both venomous reptiles and venomous amphibians shall not be transported to the site, nor shall any such animals be kept on the site at any time.
Correct.
Which you'd already agreed to in the
planning. Yeah, we would never. It just wasn't spelled out before, because that's just a common practice that no person with any sensibility and expertise in this area would ever have a venomous snake. But yet, they're legal to own in Virginia Beach with no limit on number.
Okay, well, it's down there now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any questions? I'm sorry. Mr. Earn.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Actually, I'd like to go ahead and make a motion to approve. You all have already seen what we're approving, but number one is that no animals shall be released on the subject site or within the surrounding area, which would hopefully address Mr. Min's concern. Obviously, we're not going to be releasing that. And Mr. Min's had also asked that I consider adding number 7, which reads, as you already said, Mr. Mayor, that both venomous reptiles and venomous amphibians shall not be transported to the site, nor shall any other such animals be kept on the site at any time, which is also all of those conditions, all 7 of those conditions that you had in your packet are part of my motion, and I'd ask for approval.
I've got a motion.
There's no such thing as a venomous amphibian.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Discussion?
We're not allowed to have it in anyway.
Call for the question, please.
By a vote of 10-0, you have approved the Bunny Hutch application.
Item number 7, city ordinance to amend 7.3.1 of the Oceanfront Resort District Form Based Code regarding alternative compliance for parking. Call the speakers, please.
Mr. Grenham? Reed Grenham?
We welcome you back.
Good evening, yes. My name is Reed Greenman. I'm pro bunny, so I just want to put that out there. This is just a technical thing. Because I was here tonight and I had to spend my time with you this evening, I read your packet and I read your agenda. If you don't know what I do for a living, I'm a business analyst and I write requirements and contracts. So that's what I do for a living. So I read what you published on the city council agenda talking about this item on the agenda for oceanfront form-based code. Then I read the actual ordinance that you're proposing, and I understand what you're trying to do is just simply align the oceanfront with the rest of the city, because in 2012 you changed the ordinance about the number of parking places that businesses have to have. So my remarks to you, number one, are this is a really bad ordinance. You guys did a lousy job writing this. In this ordinance, you took away your power as our elected representatives to make the decision about waivers in your policies for the number of parking spaces that businesses have to have. And in turn, you turned around and gave that to an undesignated zoning administrator, a non-elected person, who gets to make the decision. When I went back and looked at the actual section in the code that you changed, the original section said, a parking analysis shall be prepared by a professional engineer licensed to practice in the Commonwealth of Virginia to demonstrate the lesser number of spaces proposed is adequate to serve public parking demands for the use or uses served by the parking structure. Yet this change that you're proposing to extend to the oceanfront is badly written. It is undefined. It doesn't require anybody on this study. It simply says that the zoning administrator that indicates a substantial number of patrons that use our pedestrian or arrive by public transportation or bicycle shall determine whether or not you give this waiver based on the submittal of a parking study. So you went from a good requirement in your ordinance that gave you good data to make a decision with, and you turned around and lessened that to any study, as long as whoever sponsors it gives it to this unelected official to make the decision to waive the number of parking spaces that you need for businesses. Do a better job. When you make these changes to your code, don't go from more defined to less defined, and don't go from taking away your authority as my elected representative to control the things that go on our city and give it to unelected, unnamed people. So I'm sure that we won't have too much of an issue with this, but I really was struck. If I had done this in my job, I would be counseled on writing a better requirement, and if I continued to do this, I would lose my job. So you had a good ordinance, you made it worse. I'm sure you're going to vote to do this because it makes it the same throughout the city, and I understand that.
Thank you,
Jeremy.
You
guys need to look at this more carefully.
Thank you. Any other speakers?
No, Your Honor.
I guess this is the resort area.
Yes,
Mr. Arn.
And as Mr. Green had noted, this is to bring it in alignment with what all of the other zoning areas are throughout the city. And so I would move for approval.
I have a motion. Do I have a second? Then I'll get to you, Sean.
Second.
Discussion, Sean.
My only point would be, is I think Mr. Greenman made good points. So rather than going from good to go to more bad, we should go back and change and make the whole city have the same standard. I think people do elect us in our job to do our job. I do think one thing we can hear, and it's certainly clear about regulations, and there's not even ambiguous, that I think that the people, there is some accountability. So I don't know how a lawyer would ever defend all the decisions that we make, because they'd look for consistency, which there probably won't be any, I suspect. But this, we shouldn't be delegating our authority. We do too much of it already. And at least it ought to have, if it doesn't have in the code, maybe I'll bring that back for a later date, everyone should have a right to bring and appeal that decision to this body without having to go to the Planning Commission and be entitled to a vote. No administrator should have the final say on these types of issues when parking is such a huge issue everywhere and there's no visibility on how these decisions are made. I'm voting no.
Thank you, John. Any other comments? I'll call for the question, please.
By a vote of 8-2, you have adopted the ordinance.
All right. We'll now move to appointments, Mr. Vice Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, I'd like to nominate to the Audit Committee Karen Hill, John Earn, and James L. Wood. To the Health Services Advisory Board, Gia Callowagan, Ted Kubicki, Carolyn Rogers Jackson, Rolf White, and Laura Haba. To the Open Space Advisory Committee, Harry Millett. To the Social Services Board, Robin Foreman Whelan and Laurie Glaude. And to the Process Improvement Committee, Sabrina Wooten.
Do I hear any other nominations? Hearing none, I'll call for the question, please.
By 10 to 0, you have appointed those named by the Vice Mayor.
Is there any unfinished business? Is there any new business? We will adjourn this formal meeting.